I've never believed in this idea of patterning as just being vacuous. To me, patterning is always about referencing. So a pattern is essentially a distillation of information which becomes a graphic or a print or whatever it might be, but embedded within that is a lot of cultural significance. So just this working sheet here, you can begin to see the kinds of things that I've chosen in African fabric, I've chosen in Indian fabric, which for me are both sort of empire type of references. There's a really old atlas that I found which is actually of that period, so I've actually picked out African images of atlas images from Africa and with India, and then you start to basically interlace those things together. So you're obviously quoting from two areas of the world that we have quite strong cultural connections with, certainly at a certain point in time. Both areas with very strong textiles. The use of gold in there, for instance, is clearly to do with the idea of riches. It's to do with the wealth that often came from colonies. My choices there of threads. I'm using the black and white and the red threads because they're quite directional threads. So they make me think of maps. If you think about the iconography of a map, a black and white line can often be leading you to things. So you can see here, you know, Indian Empire, Northwest, you know. So though it's very old terminology in terms of the book that I'm actually using. But it's kind of interesting to sort of kind of look back at things like that, as I say, from a slightly retrospective or reflective stance. And you know the idea of the pigment, you know, I was interested to know why the British Empire was pink. I was thinking, why is the world colored pink? And apparently it's to do with the idea, it's a printer's idea really, that if you it was very difficult to put text on red for it to be red. So if you made red pink, you could actually read the text easier. Because you suddenly start thinking, why were we pink? You know, because pink is a very different kind of connotation today. And it's simply a device, really, that if you put, I guess, black text on red, it's actually quite hard to read. The title of the exhibition is Seeds of Memory, so clearly the clue is in the title in terms of, as I say, clues or ideas or quite formative things which are still influencing the work. And the new world really was a desire on my part to complete 9 new pieces, which the format's quite different, so they're circular, which obviously references the idea of an atlas or a chart or a map. I started to look at it and I got quite interested in almost thinking about colonies, really. And so the part of the rhythm here is drawn from Asia, India, and the other half of it is drawn from Africa. And then it kind of came into my head that you could also use fabrics from both of those localities as well. And this little black area of cloth that's in here is a really important piece of cloth for me, because it was an old paisley shawl. And I've had it since probably the 70s. It was given to me, or I think, by somebody, or it came into my possession. And it was so rotten that if you almost held it and pulled it, it would tear. There's things that come out of all of this which are, you know, slightly chance-led. I mean, this one, again, you've got the directional elements of the thread in there. You've got etchings, which I think are really black and white etchings, which form part of the collage, and a book on the title of the book is A Victorian Evocation. So it's about evoking an area. Again, you've got the use of the directional threads. The fabric here I'm using primarily because if you turn the fabric over, it has these wonderful almost slub lines here floats really of the back of that's the back of the cloth, but becomes a very painterly material. So to me is this notion again of territories of as a visual artist, what you want to try and find is a territory that no one's inhabited before, which is actually important. There's a series of work that I did where I got quite interested in Bosch and what people, Hieronymus Bosch, and particularly paintings like The Garden of Earthly Delights. And if you read about that, people talk about that they think that a lot of his imagery was based on a version that he received of the discovery of the Americas. And I just like this idea of a new world that somehow you're filtering through all of these different consciousnesses and people's records of it and whatever. And for myself, the idea of finding a new creative world, a new world that I can inhabit, is a really important part, clearly, of the new world's pieces. So it's bringing together in a certain in each one of the pieces a number of starting points, which to some degree will be identifiable in the work, which is the retrospective element of the exhibition. But they will be reconfigured in a completely different way. Another thing that's in there is the pieces will ultimately be framed. And again, a fairly major difference between the early works, which were, you know, quite solid and heavy and never had frames. As soon as you embrace the idea of the frame, then you can suddenly start thinking about the whole possibilities of fragility, because I can actually put things in a frame now, and I can use... There's an awful lot of paper in these materials and... in these works, and quite fragile materials, and because they're going to be encased, that's actually not a concern anymore in terms of conservation or air or dust or any of those things. So I'm really enjoying that, actually. The piece that's just here on the ground is another one, which is formed purely out of paper. And this is, again, I think, a good example of me working with a material that I have used, but there is a fragility to some of that paper. Is almost, if you crushed it, it would literally disintegrate. Again, formed from the old atlas. There is catalogues in there from America in terms of products, Sears and Roebuck, black and white imagery from a book on etching. So the choice has been made in terms of a fairly limited graphic-y black and white, a creamy patination about it, and clearly the same choices with the fabric again. And the structure of that behind the irregular grid was actually that. So I've actually infilled the areas. I can't exactly get it, but you can sort of see what's happening. So that would be black and that would be cream and so on. And what that's actually created is almost a form of territorial map. So I kind of like that idea of almost me experimenting with things and putting things together where I'm unsure of what the outcome is. And the mesh really is obviously a direct quote from work from years ago that people would probably sometimes even the first things they may have seen would have been the mesh pieces. And I haven't done any mesh pieces for a long time, but of course the mesh was always the warp and weft idea. So it was essentially the bare bones of something which you can flesh out. And of course the big difference with these is they're circular. I've never ever done circular mesh pieces before. I'm also cutting them out in a very different way, so they're being cut out industrially. So it's giving me a lot of different possibilities. But the circle, as I say, is very much the idea of the Petri dish. It's an arena where things can happen. So, you know, when I start with a piece, I will begin to put things together. And a really crucial difference, which is interesting for me, I think, is that between the older me and the younger me. So when I look back at how I might have approached a mesh piece 35 years ago, I would say the biggest difference is one of freedom. I'm a lot more easier now about what I do. And in many ways, when I come to the studio, I actually don't know what I'm going to do when I get here. It's to do with this notion of, rather than having a set idea that you then physically make, I will often start with a sort of quiet process, really, of improvisation. So there'll be enough structure to get the idea going. Whatever then comes into that working situation as the work progresses will very definitely shape the piece. You sort of have to listen to what the piece wants to do. And I think there's a tendency sometimes that people impose their own will on something. So when you've got to a certain level, you've created something, and the piece actually begins to exert its own influence. It begins to tell you perhaps what it would like to do. So for me, it's a bit like a puzzle. You've got so many things here that are working. And one of the things I'm thinking about at the moment is whether to introduce the stars, which obviously have a sort of astrological or a navigational element to them. So these are ones that I made actually last night. So So all I'm doing here now is beginning to cut them out of the fabric, which kind of releases them. For something like this, I'm likely to sort of put these on here, begin to pick out a rhythm. So I'm just looking at the crosses here, whether the red threads perhaps cross over as some kind of starting point. And then I'll just see whether that works, or I'll change, or I might bring it a different configuration. Another thing that I'm probably likely to do with something like this at a certain point in time will be to maybe think about a different layer of thread with it. So I can build up another rhythm on top of it. In this case, with a sort of fairly white, ecru-y kind of thread, and then begin to decide, like, pick out a rhythm. So I might decide to go sort of over these guys here. So I'm doing something like that. And what for me is fascinating is the idea of the mixing, so that you get to a point where, depending what your choices of what lines you use and the way that you build that up, the colours will actually optically begin to mix, which is again analogous to things like pointillism, or, as I say, hatching with a pencil, or something like building up a layer, a surface really. Quite fascinated by, you've got the fabric in there, now you've got the lace fabric, you've got the sand, you've got the thread. I can then paint that or join that to that. So you are in effect creating this almost a new ground or a new surface, which clearly has to do with the idea of the series itself. But I mean, I am quite picky about what fabrics I use, and one thing that constantly fascinates me is how clever people are, really, in many ways, about understanding what fabrics you've used. So if you put like an old-fashioned fabric with a lace fabric with something else, you start to build a series of almost mnemonic references that people actually do get. So again, it's this notion that pattern is not just happy colours, it's actually a reference, you're quoting from something, in the same way an author would quote or a musician would quote by physically sampling a sound that you might think, well, that sound goes with that. I would think about it in those terms, and I really am in a sense trying to sew with one hand, or draw with one hand and paint with the other hand, and so it is going now quite freely, I think, between all of those sorts of references, really.